The rise of social media has drastically changed politics. For better or for worse, well, that still remains to be seen.
Our next guest has an out-of-the-box solution to regulate social media platforms to stop political polarization, and that is to make them a public utility. Let's talk more about that with Dr. Ramesh Srinivasan, Professor of Information Studies at UCLA here in the United States. Dr. Ramesh, good to see you again. Thanks for joining us.
It's great to be back with you, TJ. Thank you for inviting me.
All right, good to have you on the program on this election special. And of course, Lexi is joining us from Manila, but I wanted to kick things off with this conversation about how you have studied this interesting space for the last 15 years in terms of how technology intersects with politics and culture and how changing, you know, media has changed the political discourse over time. Now, I know you're not as in tune to the Philippines situation per se, so we won't really too much on that specific, but more in general of how this world is changing because of social media, given what's happening today in the Philippines. You know, I guess it's limited to the last few years. How have you seen the power of Facebook and YouTube and Twitter really take over discourse in politics?
So TJ, every election is partly a story about technology of that time. You know, we saw that here in 2008 with the election of Barack Obama. We certainly saw this in 2016 with the election of Donald Trump and how disinformation, right, fake news went viral across different social media platforms. So as we look at the election today in the Philippines, we can also see a fundamental role of technology platforms in fueling the information people get. In fact, WhatsApp is a very dominant platform used across the Philippines and actually in many different parts of the world, across Asia, across Africa, across Latin America, and so on. And as I think you know, TJ, and I know this personally, when we're on our WhatsApp groups, we're in this kind of closed community. So we can say almost anything to the others in our group, and it could be completely false, and we would have no idea, no way of knowing it, because it's a closed loop kind of communication. And that's dominant across much of the world. But what a lot of people don't even know is that WhatsApp is a kind of texting service or a messaging service that is owned by the company Facebook, which is now calling itself Meta, right? And Facebook, as we all know in the Philippines, this was a huge issue and challenge during the election and since with President Duterte, has long been a platform that has given voice to conspiratorial, violent, hateful, and absolutely false content. And why is that? It's not because Facebook itself is looking for fake information or bad information. It's because it's gathering so much data on all of us that it's algorithmically, meaning the computational system, is selecting content based on predictions of what will capture our attention, right? The goal of any media network, like a TV station, is to keep people watching the network so then we can watch the ads, right, which is their business model. The goal of a social media network, which is also very much a media company, Facebook's the biggest media company in the history of the world. The goal of them is to keep us on their platforms all the time. So the best content to basically feed to us is content that has grabbed other eyeballs, that's captured people's attention. And one thing that always captures human beings' attention because of our psychology is crazy stuff, hateful stuff, violent stuff. So that's not, so this we know, any story, including the story today of what is going to occur in the elections in the Philippines, is very much going to be partly a story of these technology platforms and social media platforms.
It's fascinating you bring that up in terms of the messaging apps. I mean, this is something actually a different ecosystem from social media as a whole, where algorithms dominate. Yeah. But messaging apps, to your point, brings it more personal, or at least they think it's more personal, and they think they can trust it more, right? So in the Philippines, it's WhatsApp, it's Viber as well, if you're familiar with that platform. You know, you have people sharing memes, sharing links, sharing videos, similar to what they do on Facebook, but the difference is it's direct to a closed community. So you're right, to the point, that is something that those platforms can't even regulate, because that's personal communication, right? So how does that speak to the power of connectivity in that sense? And when they're fed things that they cannot trust from the internet, and they copy and paste those links to their friends and family and alumni, community, whatever, you know, what kind of power that does lead to the small circles and community.
I mean, you identified it perfectly, actually, TJ. So remember, WhatsApp might be a messaging platform and a kind of closed network platform, right? Like me and 10 members of my family or whatever, or my colleagues are discussing things on WhatsApp. But WhatsApp is a platform that's owned, as I mentioned, by Facebook/Meta. So any data that is being gathered about us on WhatsApp is data that fuels itself onto our Facebook feeds and vice versa, right? You might see them as different specific applications, but they're actually all the data is likely going to the same place, or the data is being computed in such a way so that they capture us no matter what. And so what we're seeing occurring with the example you provided is how we might get some information, you know, in this kind of disinformation or this kind of algorithmically extremist way on Facebook, and then say, oh my gosh, that captured my attention. I got to share that with all of my contacts on WhatsApp. So this is what we call in academia a media ecology, right? Like, you know, all of us today, you know, on, you know, ABS-CBN News are, sure, we're on a TV network, but actually so much of what we're doing is connected to all sorts of social media platforms. So things have a way of flowing in and out of different kinds of media platforms, including a television station, back to WhatsApp, onto Facebook, onto Twitter, and so on. That's why we've seen conspiratorial and hateful content, including here in the United States around January 6th, the insurrection, go viral across many platforms. So this is not actually simply a question about Facebook/Meta. It's really a question of how our lives, our public lives, our democratic lives, our electoral lives have become privatized and monetized and honestly manipulated by private corporate technology platforms that are using our anxieties and our emotions as sort of their raw materials for this type of digital capitalism.
I'll toss you over to Lexi in Manila, who has some questions for you as well. Lex?
Thank you.
Hi, Dr. Ramesh. It's good to meet you. I hear that you and TJ are fast friends, and I'm hoping to be the same as well. But it's really just
hang out with them.
It's really quite surprising to hear about, you know, the more quiet, closeted, you know, like WhatsApp and Viber. But do you think that it's also because when you're given something through a friend group or a family group that it's a little more trusted, I suppose? Because when you see it on Facebook or on Instagram, I mean, it's a little more public and you're not sure who's believing what. Does this attribute to that as well?
That's such a good point, Lexi, actually. Again, it's sort of like I might initially get this extremist content on Twitter, which we now know is owned by Mr. Musk, who is not about regulating the platform at all, Elon Musk, or on Facebook. But then I'm like, oh, wait a second, this is something I really want to share with my network. Or conversely, I might be getting initially the content on WhatsApp and say, oh, it's from my father, it's from my uncle, it's from my cousin. These are people that have high credibility. I might have distrust of social media, but I'm getting it in my intimate WhatsApp group from my friends, from people I know well. And then it's like, okay, well, then it's credible and I can put it back on to Facebook Meta or on any other platform, right? So this is, again, how disinformation and incorrect and extremist content ends up normalizing all of our experiences across many different platforms and channels.
But how does government get to regulate that? I mean, especially when you're supposed to be having private chats, right? I mean, I can understand the whole Facebook or, well, Twitter, Mr. Musk. I'm not sure what he's going to be doing with Twitter, but how do they regulate that? But I know that a lot of people have been also sort of moving over to other more private sort of chats as well. We've got new ones like Telegram and all of this. But then WhatsApp
That's
is
right.
still very popular in the Philippines. I mean, I haven't left it yet.
I haven't left it either because it serves a utility. Because the reason why do we use WhatsApp? It's because so many other people are on it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Why do we use Facebook? Because almost 3 billion people around the world are on it. It's the de facto, it's what we call network effects. It's captured the market, essentially. So on a regulatory level, you have to think about what are the causes for which you're regulating it, not just because it's quote unquote bad or problematic. So, you know, what I've been proposing, so I've worked with regulators, politicians, both here in the state of California, as well as people in Congress. And I have friends connected to Biden's Federal Trade Commission or who are part of it, friends/colleagues. And, you know, I think what there were a lot of slogans about break up big tech, antitrust action. That's not something that commonly occurs here in the United States, I think, as you all know. However, what I think really should be focused on is, you know, if you really think about it, like search, when you say search, it's Google, right? We even have the word Google in the English language. When we talk about social media, it's dominantly a Facebook-owned platform, right? A platform like Twitter, you're correct, has not that many users. It's about 400 million or so users. So a platform like Telegram has similar numbers. However, Twitter has huge influence on journalism, right? So its effects are not limited to its number of first order users. So I think what we need to do, and TJ mentioned this earlier, is really think about these things as public utilities, right? It's like search is part of our lives. Social media is part of our lives. Using a platform like Amazon for e-commerce is part of our lives. So those systems are just part of our lives, just like water or power, I would argue. Similar, but different, of course. So a public utility-based model would say, hey, this is a private company, but its services, we need to ensure it does not discriminate or create harms for the public. That's a whole other model. It's kind of a consumer safety, public safety type of approach. And I think that's a much more feasible approach to ensure that these guys are accountable to some sort of set of norms. And we're going to see the effects of this right now with this election right now that's occurring that you all are reporting on. So that's why we really need to protect people and protect democracies and protect some balance in our world. A regulatory approach is critical. And that can be done in a collaborative way. We don't have to focus on merely critiquing, but actually looking at how we can get everything better.
Well, before I toss you, go ahead, TJ.
Go ahead. Yeah, I just wanted to jump on that. You know, that concept of treating it as a utility. I'm trying to understand this so that I could as well make the audience understand. Can I give an example of a water utility and provide the water? And if a bad actor tries to pollute the water, you're trying to say that the government should also hold the water utility accountable for allowing whatever polluted stuff to get in the water. Is that kind of a somewhat of an analogy?
It's imagine if the water utility doesn't serve certain areas, right? Or that systematically the upkeep of the infrastructure is very poor, as we see occur in the U.S., you know, in poorer working class communities. Or we saw when there was a huge blizzard in Houston that only the grid went down for the poorer communities, but the wealthier communities were maintained to were able to siphon off the power. So it's the actions. The actions have to be serving the public. That's the point. Yeah. That's the litmus test.
Well, I did come across an article of Bloomberg. Nobel laureate Maria Ressa was saying that this presidential election will have repercussions to other elections coming up as well. It's sort of a ripple effect if Marcos wins, because social media was really, I think, his secret weapon. It wasn't so secret after all.
Well, we've seen social media actually empower and embolden neo-authoritarian figures around the world. I don't claim to have specific knowledge about Marcos himself, but I think, you know, we've seen this occur with Jair Bolsonaro in Brazil, with the elevation of a sort of a neo-authoritarian figure in Narendra Modi in India. We've seen it occur with Viktor Orban in Hungary. We've seen it occur with Trump here in the United States. And the reason why, again, is because the content that these folks put out is conspiratorial, is inflammatory, at times is violent, is, you know, dog whistling, we call it here, where you're kind of race baiting or other things like that. You're blaming people. And just that content grabs people's attention. I mean, Donald Trump was the best thing possible in a certain sense for getting eyeballs on the media, not just with tech platforms, but also with CNN, MSNBC, and so on, right? Because people can't take their eyes off this kind of stuff because it provokes this psychological response of fight or flight. And that's just not healthy for living. Of course, in any culture, in any population, there are going to be people saying hateful stuff. That's part of protecting free speech. But the hateful voices should not become the public sphere. The hateful voices should not become the new normal and erode elections and manipulate the public interest.
Dr. Amish, before we let you go, I wanted to touch a bit on the pace, the speed of content and information. And we had a bit of this discussion the last time I spoke to you, and I found it very interesting to look at in terms of how fast these bits of information come in, whether true or untrue. And to your point, psychologically, humans don't have the time to process them, right? They don't have the time to figure out this is real or not. And especially now with TikTok, really becoming the, right. the dominant platform, that's scary. If you're talking about how that pace can really manipulate someone's minds and thoughts and feelings, and the way the TikTok platform works vis-a-vis the Facebook platform, it's kind of a daunting task to try to make people understand and think and reflect on what they're reading.
That's right. Speed is a huge reason why our experiences online and with our applications on our phones and so on are disorienting, right? It's very difficult to be able to have cognitive presence, let alone embodied presence, with the speed of information, because we're all multitasking all the time. We're all just getting so much information on so many different platforms, and it's coming at us in lots of different directions. And that's just overwhelming for the human nervous system and our ability to kind of sit with information and really kind of be literate, right? Literacy here, not just about regurgitating something, but actually processing it and thinking about it. So it's a huge part of the challenge here, is that very issue. And you're totally right. I mean, as we look at the kind of latest layer of social media, it's not Facebook, it's Instagram, which is owned by Facebook, it's Snapchat, and it's TikTok, which is owned by ByteDance, which is a Chinese company. And all of them are even more kind of fast moving little clips, a lot of information that's obviously in many ways obviously being doctored or edited, you know, fake information or just kind of manipulated videos, right? Filters. This is the new normal, right? So it's very hard to vet that or to have any sort of experience of, forget truth, but just sort of any sort of experience of clarity around these streams of and feeds of information coming at us. And so that's why the first thing I do with my students at UCLA, TJ, is to get them to take at least 24 hours. I know they're kind of moaning about it. To take 24 hours, no devices whatsoever. Not because we're gonna ever live in a world without these devices, but just so we know our own capacities, our predispositions to kind of be anxious, to be disoriented, and to have trouble really paying attention to things in a deeper way. And so this is a huge issue with emotional health, with mental health. The Facebook whistleblower came out with internal studies that actually corroborated what many of us scholars have been writing about and journalists have been writing about, that they are feeding people Instagram-oriented content, and TikTok is similar, that tends to reinforce a sense of you're never good enough, or kind of fear of missing out, what we call FOMO, right? You're kind of like, you're never good enough, and that keeps drawing you in. How do I get better? How do I become part of the club? All of these things. So we have to think about our health as human beings and as parts of societies and democracies and cultures. And we have to drive digital technology so it serves all of us, including businesses, but not in this way that is pitting us all against one another.
I mean, Dr. Amish, that's such a good point, because really, I feel like I have 25 tabs open at the same time. I mean, and the thing is, it's really the next generation that's suffering from it. I mean, we've got a lot of these wonderful athletes and, you know, model citizens, very, very young, dying by suicide because they're just feeling like they're not good enough. Now, how is we, well, obviously, I'm a mother, right? But how can maybe the older generation, or just people in general, how can they stop and say, you know what, we can't also just be open all the time? How do we as a community sort of also edit or so be part of the change to not be as influenced? Or, you know, I mean, it's just very difficult. It's too much, too fast.
I think we have to lose our sort of kind of our sense that the world that's being fed to us is the real world, right? That's a world that is sort of like, imagine if you have goggles on, but those goggles are made by a particular company. Not, I don't even mean Meta Quest. and it's like a different world that's being offered to you. So I think if we take a different mindset where we sort of see all this information coming at us as sort of just streams of information, just kind of curated kind of feeds, rather than actually the wider world, and we need to support real journalism, independent journalism, because that's a different thing altogether, right? The problem is these two worlds have collided with one another, and the world of just eyeballs and grabbing people's attention, has taken over and created a lot of challenges for journalists and threatened the careers of many journalists in terms of their jobs. The field is in trouble as a result. So we need to have all of us just have a sense that this is not the real world that's being presented to us. Our youth, I think it's not about shaming anyone, but they need to understand this. And I think we need a much more balanced sort of educational system where from the beginning, we actually understand not just technology in and of itself, but technology's relationship to all of us and to humanity. So I think that, in the other side of it, these regulatory approaches are really important. We've seen a lot of employees in tech companies stand up and say, hey, this is not good enough. We're not going to do this. We've seen racial issues, misogyny issues, other kinds of issues occur, not just at Facebook, at Google, other companies as well. They need to be pressured, and they need to be pressured to ensure also, because they're making the most money ever in the history of the world. The top 10 wealthiest people in the world during the pandemic doubled their wealth. 8 of them are connected to tech. That's not surprising because we were all on our screens, right? Yet many of them are not paying any taxes. This is supporting an economy that's more unequal on a global level at the moment. And we need to do things to actually ensure that we have the economic measures in place so this massive transfer of wealth, kind of a new feudal type of system, is something we don't let occur. So there's lots of different layers and lots of different interventions. And the reason I'm quite excited and passionate about this is because I think there's a great deal we can do to kind of restore balance.
And I'm sure election season doesn't help either, because obviously these people who are making all of the money, I mean, this is the best time to do it, because people are you know, going to be influenced, and people want to hear, you know, right from wrong, and the disinformation is just out there.
It's a huge issue moving forward. And I think it's also important to note, like here in the United States, the biggest lobbyists in many cases in the federal government, during the Obama administration, by the way, as well, was Google, right? And that companies like Google and Amazon and Facebook are all getting military contracts as well. So you should no longer understand these companies as just a Google search or Gmail or like Facebook newsfeed. These are the biggest companies in the history of the world trying to take over every vertical imaginable, right? Like we used to have independent taxis. There still are some, including I'm sure in Manila, but Uber's obliterated much of the taxi industry all around the world. So these are just examples. Airbnb is another example with hotels. So I think we just need to understand, like, it's not okay for someone sitting thousands of miles away to manipulate our entire transportation system thousands of miles away from there, in the case of Uber, for example. So I think the question is not merely about social media, but more generally the technologization in private interest of all of our lives around the world. We're talking billions of people here.
All right. Thank you very much for joining us, Dr. Amish. I'm not sure where TJ is, but I'm saying goodbye on his behalf as well.
Yeah, thank you.
There you go. I was going to say, maybe TJ wants to say goodbye.
Yeah. I also wanted to ask Dr. Amish to promote his book, a very fascinating book, your social media. Where can they find you if you want to learn more about what you shared yesterday? I feel like Lexi and I just sat in a lecture in UCLA today.
I would love it. I mean, and I want to keep hanging out and being back on. And now I have some great friends in the Philippines and you here, TJ. You can follow me on Twitter at Ramesh Media, RamesMedia. And you'll notice I don't tweet very much. Perhaps that's part of what we're talking about. And my last book, I've written a few. My last book was called Beyond the Valley. And that's a book that really gives a blueprint for how has tech come to take over our lives, and not necessarily in a negative way, but also looking at a lot of alternatives where different technologies, AI technologies, machine learning systems, digital networks of all kinds, serve people and communities all around the world. So I do field work in Africa, South Asia, I gotta come to the Philippines, Latin America, and so on. So I just wanna tell everyone, you know, you're in the Philippines or all around the world, the diaspora. This story about technology should not be defined by North America and Europe. This story should be really defined by all of our relationships around this planet with technology, and how it can bring all of us up, how it can empower. Certainly possible.
All right. On that note, thank you so much. Really, thank you so much, Dr. Amish. We'll have you again soon as we learn more about these powerful tools of social media and how it affects our daily lives. That's Dr. Amish Srinivasan of the UCLA. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
More news now. An analyst asserts that the results of the presidential race are so far consistent with pre-election surveys. Attorney Tony Lavinia, former dean of the Ateneo School of Government, is predicting a landslide.